Today we're going to record our lecture with my nephew in the background.
What?
Hello everyone, this is DSPS 285, Banking for Apartment Living, with Mr. Carlston, week 3, lecture 1. How much does it cost to move into a new place? That's what we're talking about. You need to know a few things, of course, and this is what we're going to talk about. First is furnished or unfurnished. Some apartments or rooms to rent in a house offer a furnished or unfurnished place. A furnished apartment or place has necessities such as a couch, bed, dresser, table, chairs, and other furniture. This is not your furniture, yet is available for you to use. Realize that if you get a furnished apartment and you accidentally damage a couch, bed, or table, the landlord can charge you to buy a new one. An unfurnished apartment or place is a completely empty place where you must provide the furniture. Now, if you damage your own furniture, your landlord will not charge you to fix or replace it because it is yours, right? Another thing you need to know is about rental insurance. Rental insurance is just like car registration or requiring a license to drive a car. Your landlord requires you to have rental insurance. Rental insurance is financial protection against loss, which is a good thing, like car insurance. This protects your belongings and things in your apartment. For example, if someone decides to break into your apartment or there's a big leak that damages your things, your insurance pays for it. You could pay as much as $150 per person per month, depending upon how big or small your place is, all right? So an example of when rental insurance helps you. Steve was excited about moving to his first apartment in Anaheim. He has a good job as a stock person supervisor at a supermarket and goes to college to become a nurse. One night while working late, someone unfortunately decides to break into Steve's apartment. The thief took Steve's expensive Apple MacBook Pro, his television, and a $1,000 pair of Louis Vuitton shoes he bought for his girlfriend. Of course, Steve was upset, so he filed a claim with his rental insurance and told him that someone broke into his apartment and stole some very expensive belongings. The rental insurance company said okay and paid him enough to replace all the items he lost. Steve was back to normal in about a month and finally gave his girlfriend those $1,000 Louis Vuitton heels. She did not like them because she wanted Nikes. Oh, how mean, right? So this was an example of when the rental insurance helps you. Okay. We also talked about the security deposit. And there's something you need to know. Remember, a security deposit is money paid to the landlord when a lease agreement is signed, in case the renter, who is you, damages the apartment or decides to violate the terms of the lease. The landlord will use the security deposit. If you are responsible, you can get your security deposit back at the end of the lease. Here are ways to keep and or lose your security deposit, okay? Do you remember Joe and Karen? This refers to damage to the apartment. If you remember, we talked about two people, Joe and Karen. Joe was not very responsible and had parties and friends at his house every weekend. His parties and friends damaged the apartment, leaving stains in the nice carpet, and they even damaged the wall and put a hole in it. Also, because there were so many people visiting his apartment, the bathroom toilet and bathtub were dirty and severely damaged. Joe was not getting his $3,000 security deposit back. This is an example of Joe, who was not very responsible and did not take care of his apartment. He will not get his $3,000 security deposit, right? The other person we talked about was Karen. Karen, on the other hand, was responsible. She did not have a lot of parties and only invited friends who respected her place. She always kept her place clean, so she will get her $3,000 back. This is important. You want to keep your place clean so you can get your $3,000 back. Remember, if you get your apartment clean and you return it after a year, just as clean or even better, you can probably get your $3,000 back. Okay? Now, violating the terms in a lease. This is for your security deposit. What does that mean? What does it mean to violate the terms of a lease? Remember, a lease is a contract to live in an apartment for a specific length of time. Some lease agreements can be month to month or every year. If you sign a lease agreement for 1 year, which is 365 days, and you decide to live in the apartment for 2 months, this is a violation of terms. Remember, you signed a contract to live in an apartment for a year or 365 days, but after 2 months you said, I don't want to live anymore. You cannot do that. That is a violation of the contract. Another way people can violate the terms of a lease is if the contract says you cannot have pets or smoke in the apartment. Therefore, if you get caught with a pet or smoking in your apartment after you said, I'm not going to have any pets or smoking, you can not only get kicked out, but also lose the security deposit as well. So make sure you read your lease before you sign it, even if you think it's a good deal. All right. Another thing you should know before you move in. First and last month's rent. Most lease agreements require you to pay the first and last month's rent. So before you move in, you must pay at least 2 months of rent in advance. For example, I want to move into an apartment on January 1st, 2020. The rent is $2,300 per month. This requires that I pay the month rent for January 2020 and January 2021. This means that I must pay $4,600, which is January 2020 and January 2021 in advance. All right. So another thing that you need to know as well. We talked about first and last month's rent, pets in the apartment. I know a lot of us love our pets. We talked about having pets. Some of us need our pets and some of us can do without them. Many apartments charge fees to have your pets in the apartment. Some apartments require a $500 deposit and a $50 fee once a month. This is in addition to the rent you pay. So the question is, are you willing to pay extra for this cat or dog to have in your place? So, how much can it feasibly cost? How much can it feasibly cost just to move into, this is a 1 or 2 bedroom, this is probably a fancy place, okay? First and last month's rent, rent is $2,300 per month for a 1 bedroom, okay? So again, I have to pay for first and last month's rent, so this is $4,600. The security deposit at this place is $3,000, okay? The cost to set up the utilities, which is water, gas, electric, and cable, which provides internet and TV, is $300, all right? Renter's insurance is $1,200. This is divided up into 6 months, so I will pay $200 a month, all right? Pet deposit. Let's pretend I have a pet, a cat. So this is $500 for the fee, and then I will pay $50 per month. So the potential cost or the possible total just to move into an apartment depending upon where I choose can be as high as $8,600. That is just to move in. Now this is a high estimate, right? Let's look at something a little bit more reasonable. This is for a cost for maybe a studio apartment in Anaheim. The rent is $900 per month. So first and last month's rent, which is 2 months, is $1,800. The security deposit here is less. It's $1,000. The cost to set up the utilities, water, gas, electric, and cable TV, which gives me internet for the TV, is the same at $300. Renter's insurance is the same, $1,200 divided up into 6 months is $200 per month. I have a pet little kitty, right? So that's a $500 deposit. So the cost to move in is $3,800, okay? Do you see how I can save money? And this is the next slide. How can you save money? That's a lot of money. $3,800, okay, versus $8,000, that's almost $9,000. That's a lot. All right, so how can I save money? If you do not have a pet, you can save money when you move in and on your monthly expenses. Remember, a pet deposit can be almost $500 when you move in and an additional $50 to your rent every month. Without a pet, you are saving at least $500 when you move in and $600 every year. Okay? Insurance depends on how big or small your apartment is. You can pay less than $60 a month depending upon what you want to protect, right? Another way you can save money, get a roommate. It may be difficult to live with someone, but you save a lot of money. You get to split expenses between you and your roommate. For example, if you decide to live in a nice place on the beach, you might be able to afford it with an honest roommate. So if the rent is $2,000 to rent an apartment on the beach with a roommate, you only pay $1,000 a month. It might be worth it, all right? So what do you think? Is it worth it to be independent, live on your own? This is why we went through our needs and wants. What can you live without and what must you live with? When you move into a place, you must decide what you can do to save money. Maybe having Disney Plus would be nice, but it is not something you can afford right now. Not having Disney Plus right now is okay. You will survive. Same thing with pets. I love my pet, but you save so much money without a pet, right? So what is your homework assignment for this lecture? Please leave your name as a comment so I know that you have watched this lecture. Go to assignments or quizzes and take the how much would you spend per month survey on Canvas. At the end of the survey, it asks you to total your expenses for the month. Tell us how much you plan to spend per month given your needs, okay? So I am going to close this. I'm going to switch over here. Okay, hang on. All right. So this is the quiz. I'm in assignments. Purpose of the survey. How much would you spend per month? It asks you, how much do you plan to spend on rent every month? Put an answer. Do you plan on spending $1,000? $900, okay? Question two, how much do you plan on spending a month for a cell phone, all right? How much do you plan on spending each month for utilities, such as gas, water, and electricity? If you plan on spending money for cable and your internet every month, how much do you plan to spend? If you think cable and internet is a want where you can do without it, put zero, all right? Question five, transportation. Do you plan on driving a car or taking the bus? How much do you plan on spending each month for a car payment or to take the bus? If you have a car, you also have to account for car insurance and gas. How much do you plan on spending for that? Okay, question six, food and groceries. How much do you plan on spending for food every month? Food and groceries are a variable expense, so the amount will change depending upon how much you buy and eat every month. So how much do you plan to spend every month for groceries and food? Question seven, personal hygiene. How much do you plan on spending for haircuts, nails, and hair every month? Everyone needs to maintain their personal hygiene. So how much are you willing to spend for it every month? Okay, question eight. These are things like toilet paper, paper towels, cleaning supplies, a vacuum, and other things you need to keep your place nice and clean. How much do you plan on spending per month for household items like toilet paper? All right. Question nine. Now add all your expenses and see how much they are. This is a monthly expense, so you need to have a job where you can afford this amount every month. What is your monthly expense? So once you answer all those questions, click submit, and that is it. I will go over this on the Zoom tomorrow, Monday at 12:30 is our classroom Zoom. I hope you guys are okay. Stay safe, and I'll see you tomorrow. All right, bye.